important thing. I was taught a great love of my country. A great love of the people of the country. All my country had gone through. All my friends and people I didn't know had gone through.
Britney, what is right now? Slave for Britney. Hit me, Britney, one more time. Number one.
What up, Doc?
This week on Cribs, we're taking...
Boland emerges as one of the great spiritual leaders of the 20th...
But that's where the problems begin.
Keep the noise as a public comfortable pressure.
The junky
turn. Wet processing.
Your hose and warm
ideally suited for
foot pedal sealer.
A moment
bit of Bohemia Creed. What lies underneath? Touch of tone, naked law. Average isn't enough.
Dress into a $5 gun belt. Your hose and warm,
ideally suited for
foot pedal sealer.
A moment
bit of Bohemia Creed. What lies underneath?
Nights.
Touch of tone, naked law. Average isn't enough.
Dress into a $5 gun belt.
Your first city is here,
the Amaris Practice Center.
Ideal.
The Bonnie retail shares its white foam.
Was saturated
with family donating an unexpected turn.
Very rare psychological
value. Variable depth.
Additional.
It does not have to be the indestructible. Never voiced
here.
Seen curse
off stage. Cheer told me.
Choice. Fearless used. I hear death
do.
Almost.
I'm already
what
dead.
He's something else
been able.
He remembered
radio former green.
Because if I can
suit seem to
don't allow
shoe shine there.
Walk.
Trying
to
background
everything.
The first father cycle gives exclusion.
Primary
out
there.
Childhood.
Oh, good.
Abandoned.
Comfort.
Here
was
three.
My train tracks.
It's the B Blank Consort.
Oh, it was?
And that's the name of our group, and it varies from 3 to 5 people, depending on the personnel available and the pieces we're performing. And most of the pieces we do are written by us or made by us in collaboration between us or with other people involved. For example, Scott has scored some of my poems for 4 voices, and I've done the same with other people's stuff.
Next,
I've done visual poetry seriously for about 20 years. And I was always concerned about the fact that there weren't any anthologies available that contained the work of contemporary visual poets. The last one was done in around 1970. I got together with Craig Hill, and we edited a book called Writing to Be Seen, which is over there. And we've been trying to publicize the book mainly, although we've practically sold out the first printing. And
how many did you make?
It was a limited edition of 500.
Okay, well, that's good for you.
That's a large edition.
That's a large amount to get rid of. That's good for you.
Our kind of art. So anyway.
As I was talking to one of my friends, and he said, who's not involved in any of this, and I said, well, I got an email from Carl Jung today, and she burst out laughing, and she said, and you're going to tell me you got a postcard from Sigmund Freud? So. This is Carl, K-A-R-L, Young, Y-O-U-N-G.
Carl is actually the publisher of the book. Bob Grumman and Craig Hill are the editors, but Carl, with his Light and Dust Press, is the person who did a lot of the work of actually getting this published. You know, the graphics work, putting it together, getting it to the printer, and getting it out to all of us.
As well as a terrific website, too.
Yes, Light and Dust. Definitely, it's one of the best visual poetry websites.
Was there a lot of special things that he had to do to print the book, or color printing? And
No. Well, the cover. Uh-huh. The cover, but there isn't color inside.
Black and white inside.
We're still not to the point where we can afford that.
Uh-huh, I understand.
You know. So it wouldn't have been beautiful if we could have, you know, but there just isn't the money available for color printing.
This is a poem written by myself and Jim Lethwich, scored for four voices. Oh, who's blue? That's me. Okay, M-Po.
That's scored a little different.
This is scored for four voices. The piece was written by Bennett and Leftwich, mm-hmm. and divided up the colors according to the order the people were standing in.
Okay, there's a different kind.
Okay.
This is a cutout poem based on Ficus's work.
Ficus Strangulensis.
Uh-huh. And familiar what it is. One person, three stanzas, five lines per stanza. I, for example, in this case, did the first line, sent it off with just the first line. I sent this one to Ficus, and then he added the second line in all of them. And then the third line in this case was Kathy Merle, Bennett, and John, and they finished the poem by doing the third line. So in this case now, when we performed it, these three lines were done once, then the next three. And this is a cutout poem.
I'm Kathy Ernst. I make strange poetry and strange noises.
Hi, I'm Scott Helms. I'm from
Minneapolis and been a friend of these people for about 20 years and doing visual poetry since 74. And
well, I'm John M. Bennett. I'm a poet, a visual poet, a sound poet, a publisher, a librarian, a Latin Americanist scholar, a father, cook, a bunch of other stuff. I'm busy all the time.
My name is Michael Peters. I'm a writer, poet, visual poet, and a musician. And I was here to assist the blank counselor in their presentation this evening, which I think you got some of that on tape, didn't you?
Oh, I did. That's why I'm asking you this.
It's a little rough. We're actually going into the studio tomorrow to record it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Friend down in Chinatown has a studio, so we're going to go in there, and it's going to be kind of exciting, because I think for the first time we'll actually be able to sort of control it a little bit, and probably make a couple run-throughs, which... I think it's received like a lot of good response so far. We did the same thing at the Avant-Garde Symposium this summer.
Oh, you did in Ohio?
Yeah, in Columbus.
Are you from here or there?
I actually grew up in Ohio.
We started doing this at the Atlantic Center for the Arts when we were all there on a residency in June 2001. And, performed since several times and are about to make our first CD.
Oh, you should. And your first video.
Three-way accident, maybe.
Please, this was the last line. Now, who actually
ended up that way? We don't know.
Yeah, you have no idea.
Oh, so it would have been this line, though, by somebody.
Well, we would have said them all at once. Let's do it. Scott?
Yeah, the last stanza.
Let's just read them again.
Are just one more three-way accident.
Now, wait a minute. How did you do that? Oh, I see. You each read one line at the same time.
Yeah, that's what we did through the whole thing.
Gotcha.
So we never know how it's going to end up.
And how we're
going to
end up.
Some of these we've read performed at several different places.
The title of this one is On CD and Vinyl LP Bag Web. And that is on the, if you recorded that one, that's the title.
These were in the middle.
Yeah, okay. I think he was here by then. And I did this part that started out seedless. Who did?
I did the top part.
And I was screw kidney to save.
Okay. On CD and vinyl LP.
I do language work in various media, books, straight books, experimental books, conceptual books, audio, video, film, holography, and I've done so all my life.
Paper
Most, not all, of these poetry books, by unknown or obscure poets, contain traditional free verse or traditional meter and rhyme verse. How boring. Is it any wonder that many of these little books wind up on 99-cent bargain table, more likely than in the wastebasket? What excites and motivates me is experimental poetry, visual poetry, poetry that is unique, poetry that is daring and takes risks, poetry that entices the reader to take a second look, and having done that, to become involved in the poet's total articulation of the poem and the animation of the blank page. I cannot be Rimbaud, Whitman, Blake, or Shakespeare, so why imitate them? Art has always rebelled against the old ways of doing things and sought the new. Visual poetry, which is what I mainly write, is an augmentative synthesis of literary and visual art. It's not just a matter of letters or words in the shape of objects they signify, or ideograms like concrete poetry in the 1950s, or a return to cave drawings or runes or hieroglyphs, but a total historic look at the language continuum and the use of any of those technologies to animate, to resonate, to expand the consciousness of the poem. Even the empty space of the blank page can, through adroit manipulation and juxtaposition of the text, be made to sing. My experience as an artist photographer has afforded me a rich repertoire of imagery to draw on. I use visual art techniques to compose and realize my poems. Collage, frottage, fromage, dry transfer letters, stenciling, and calligraphy, I think he means to say, something else here. As well as a humble, manual, portable typewriter, are viable to my way of creating the visual poem. It is as if a poet and illustrator combined into one individual. Another kind of poetry I compose is that intended to be read aloud or performed, and is variously called sonic poetry, sound poetry, or sound text poetry. Emphasis here is given to sound over sense, so that this poetry subtly and abstractly approaches the realm of pure music. One particularly important but overlooked characteristic of experimental poetry is its internationalism. It is widely practiced around the world and is a vital endeavor of the international avant-garde. Because of this, work of mine is published in many countries outside the US, in Japan, Italy, Brazil, England, France, among them. Visual poets exhibit as well as publish, and hence I've been exhibited across the United States and overseas more often than I've been published there. That is by Bill Keith, who's really a remarkable visual poet, and most of the things that he said there, I would say, were applicable to my work.
Okay, this is going to be an experimental piece.
Oh, yeah, that's working.
Very changed.
Okay, we'll put our experimental heads on.
Yeah.
Like experimental in a sense, I don't really know what we're doing here. This is a long poem in five cantos. Let's try the first and see how it goes. You do the first line, second line, third line, fourth line of each stanza here.
We'll just stop.
And then we'll stop and do the next one, if unless we're completely discombobulated.
Okay.
The title of the whole series is called Spank, and this canto is called School.
Hence your stream hole splashes out
inside my
slashing faucet
breathing, or was right.
Was a storm patched water fist and
contained in the pocket
slickers at the
spot
from my first bus
Work on a little part and then we save change and we move it away. We move it around and we all brought materials with us.
kinds of materials, and it's actually a conversation on paper. We didn't talk in words, even though we consider ourselves visual poets. We spoke with images on the paper while we were in the room, so it was a quiet conversation going on at the same time.
David Cole, a dear friend of many of us, who lived in Brooklyn Heights for a long time, then went to Minnesota, then came back to New Jersey, collaborated a lot with me, with Marilyn, and with Despo.
There's also other works here which David, I think, has created. This is one of his works over here. And David likes to like to recycle his work from one piece to another, and he would use the photocopy machine, and he made an edition here in colored copies, probably a very small edition, and it could even be a one-of-a-kind book. It probably is more or less one-of-a-kind book with sections that came from other things.
Yes, it was summer before last. I went to a creative residency at Atlantic Center for the Art. Richard Castellanos was the master artist. And this was a piece I did to take down there to show the other people who were there what I'd been up to. Other people who were there are also here tonight. Scott Helms, John Bennett, and Michael Peters were among those were in this particular group. So I've been very interested in the quilt as a conceptual poem. The quilt. Because I see meter and rhythm in the way a quilt, an old-fashioned traditional quilt. My God, people are making quilts these days, as you wouldn't believe. But at any rate, this is a conceptual quilt for me, and also a poem. I've been working a lot more in other pieces. I just did two new quilts, and I've also been working in larger wall hangings and in fabric like this. This is actually done on the computer and printed on fabric.
And how is that? What's
I also I like to do sculptural pieces with three-dimensional letters.
I really like that.
I have lots of these. The problem with them is they tend to be very fragile, so it's hard to you can't just like mail them anywhere without going to a lot of work. But I love the idea. I was somewhat dyslexic as a child, so to me, it's my theory that dyslexics see everything three-dimensionally. Therefore, a lowercase d is you're just looking at a b from the other side. You know what I mean?
I mean, you had to think about it more because you were dyslexic. You had to think about the letter.
Well, not really. I just see them as the same letter. I mean, B, and it just depends on whether I'm standing in front of it or behind it. So I became interested in dealing with letters as objects instead of as a flat thing. So I have a whole series of these. This one evolved from my discovering that if you take the L off of lover, it's over. So that's why it's titled Goodbye.
It's titled what, I'm sorry?
Goodbye.
Ah.
Tell us about David.
And then somebody else pointed to me, yeah, goodbye, get the L out. The other piece of mine that's in this case, and it's also the third and last piece I have in this show myself, is the color cover plate from the book Writing to Be Seen. It's a piece.
This one.
I don't know, you might be able to get it. It's a computer piece. What I was trying to do here is think, what would you do if you could apply
I'm just getting an alternative viewpoint. I won't use the sound. Oh, this is Bob's stuff. I can't remember your name, but I know it has Saint in it. It's something Saint.
Yeah, Saint Gregory.
Saint Albans. It's okay. I'm just getting an alternative viewpoint. I won't use the sound.
The sound is what I'm concerned about. Okay.